Good morning and welcome everyone to the seventh meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2022. We are taking some evidence first off as part of agenda item one, consideration of continued petitions. Petition number 1804 is the first of those, to halt Highlands and Islands Airport Limited air traffic management strategy. This is a petition lodged by Alistair McKeegan, John Doig and Peter Henderson on behalf of Benbecula Community Council and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to halt a Highland and Islands Airport Limited's air traffic management strategy project and to conduct an independent assessment of the decisions and decision-making process of the ATMS project. We last considered this petition on the 2nd of February, where we agreed to write to the Civil Aviation Authority and to hear evidence from the petitioners and Prospect today, and then again on the 18th of May from Highal. I'm delighted that we're joined by the two representative MSPs who've been following this petition at its various torturous stages of progress through our proceedings, Rhoda Grant and Liam MacArthur. Welcome to you both. And I'm delighted to welcome Peter Henderson, who is joining us virtually, who is one of the petitioners, who is going to give evidence today. Firstly, I would ask members if they have any questions they would like to explore with Peter. Peter, is there anything you would just like to say before we launch into questions to you?
Well, I still have some concerns I'd like to raise. I don't know if you'd like to hear them. I was hoping that somebody from Highal would be there to answer them, but they don't seem to be.
Okay, well, why don't we move to the questions? Because that might bring out some of the reservations that you still currently have, and we'll see what comes as we do that. But the first question basically tees that up, which is to ask what concerns you may have about the agreement between Highal and Prospect Trade Union on the future development of air traffic control, and if so, how they may be addressed.
Well, one of the first things is the Digital Audit Scotland Assurance of Action Plan, published in October 2021. On page 11, it said that it became evident from the remote terror procurement and SES REBA 3 design that the programme in its current form exceeds the programme budget, which is £48.4 million. I was hoping Highal could explain that, because I think that's probably what drove them back to the negotiating table, rather than listening to anything that the committee and the petitioners have said. So that's one thing.
So your position is you want to know whether it was a cost-driven change of heart rather than a mea culpa, we might have got it wrong, change of heart?
Yes. I mean, basically, I would like to know, you know, did the remote terror procurement and the design of the remote terror centre at New Century House play a part in actually writing off the entire programme rather than anything we've done? Because I suspect that's the truth. The second point, if I can raise a second point, Highal were due to take over the running of Tumber Radar from the National Air Traffic Service last September. It's pretty straightforward transferring, you would think, an existing radar service into Highal's control. They were due to take over in September, then December, then this April, and nobody now knows when or if they're going to take over the Tumber Radar. From that, the story seems to be that they have recruited 9 controllers. They haven't managed to train them. Some have left, and the programme, they may not take it over for a year until a year from now, which seems to be a bit disastrous. Considering that Highal actually want to have a centralised radar service for all of the airports based in Inverness, if they can't recruit and staff for one airport, how can they recruit and staff for all the airports and guarantee that they can provide a service? Inverness already struggles to provide controllers, and it shuts twice a day every day and probably will do for a year. The radar part of it shuts. So my worry is that if Highal centralise all radar, who are they going to prioritise? Are they going to prioritise somewhere in Inverness airports over all the other airports to make sure that they can provide a service to them? Are they going to shut other airports to man Inverness and Sumbra? I don't believe that they're capable of running a centralised service, which is what they want to do. They can't staff, recruit or train for Inverness at present, or Sumbra, it would seem. So how can they do it for the entire, all of the airport systems?
What Well, I'll pause there. I mean, you've looked for an independent assessment. What do you think the independent assessment would deliver?
I think it would shine a light on how we have a team appointed by HIAL. We have existing HIAL management. They've exhibited that the HEMS project that they said was the only way forward has failed miserably. They still want to progress with an air traffic management system which centralises. It seems to be failing at the moment. The current management and teams in place don't seem to be able to run this properly, and I would like somebody from the outside to ask why that's the situation and why it still threatens the reliability of our air traffic services. We don't seem to have progressed. ATMS still exists in principle, but the aims are changing, but they still seem to want to centralise rather than start from scratch and have a proper look at it. It's none of this project has worked, and yet they keep stumbling on the same people making the same decisions.
And if you take the view that you do, how do you think HIAL should have approached the development of this project in the first place?
By listening to their staff, which they refused to do, by listening to the communities, which they refused to do, which is why we took this to the Petitions Committee, why our politicians backed us, why our community councils, local councils backed us. The staff are now being engaged with, because HIAL were basically forced into that situation. Prospect, the union, are now actively trying to sort out the mess that's happened, and yet, you know, there now seems to be a whole new ATMS being developed without any oversight, as far as I can see, from anybody outside of HIAL.
And plainly, I think from the submissions you've given subsequently, and along from the petitioners, the concerns that were expressed, what did you feel HIAL's response and management of those concerns was like?
Well, initially they ignored everything, said that ATMS was the only way forward. There was a sudden change of heart, which I suspect was brought about by budgetary constraints, which meant they couldn't achieve anything. And now they're looking for a way out, so they've decided to negotiate. They haven't really been honest and open about anything all the way through, as you know, as we have found out.
And just a final question from me, which sits just slightly on the back of evidence we've received. Why would you, or what evidence would you have that the Civil Aviation Authority would ultimately authorise anything that was unsafe?
Well, they won't authorise anything that's unsafe, but we were at a meeting with the regulator, the CA regulator, and he kind of summed it up saying that if you came to me and said you want to fly a rocket to the moon, I would say that in principle that's fine. If you then came back to me with a cardboard rocket, I would turn you down. HIAL seem to be coming up with a cardboard rocket most of the time. It's not until the final phases that the CAA will sign something off. They've encouraged HIAL to scope some trials of the surveillance system that they wish to use. There's been no word on whether HIAL actually want to do those trials and foot the bill. They seem to be sitting back and waiting for regulations to change in their favour rather than actively seeking solutions. So the CAA probably won't, well, the CAA should not sign off anything that's unsafe, but they will wait until the whole project has been decided on and then sign off on whether or not they'll accept it. They do the same with controlled airspace. You can put everything in place. The final judgment is down to the CAA. If they decide that something is not suitable, they will tell you why it's not suitable, and you can either then try and change it or not.
Okay.
But HIAL are trying to operate out with what are existing regulations. It's new territory which HIAL need to fund solutions for.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to witnesses. How would you like to see HIAL involve communities served by its airports in the development of future plans and proposals?
Well, rather than coming out with a done deal, they need to at least have a consultation that's put out in public in much the same way as other government departments do. You know, these are our aims and our goals. Would you like to comment on them? And a consultation should mean just that. They should actually listen to what people say and have a a conversation with them. You know, what we want basically on the islands is a good, reliable service that doesn't let us down. Coming up with ideas that basically remove all of the resilience from our local areas is not a good idea. They just need to be a little bit more open, and they haven't been. They just seem to make a decision and expect everybody to go along with it, which is not really what... Any question?
Yeah, no. The final question, Convener, and this is your opportunity here. The committee will take evidence from representatives of Hyo and Prospect. Is there any particular issues you'd like us to raise with them, and why?
Well, the evidence from Hyo, you know, as I say, the Digital Assurance Scotland Assurance of Action Plan, when they say that the remote care procurement and rebus redesign for the programme exceeds the current budget, does that mean that two aspects of the entire project cost more than the 48.4 million? And is that what drove them back to the negotiating table? Why is Sumber Radar a mess and way behind schedule? Because if they can't take over an existing radar service for an airfield, how can they be expected to run a centralised radar service for all the airfields? Hyo, in their evidence previously submitted, said that, you know, none of the petitioners are directly involved in the programme or directly impacted by it. Well, we are impacted by everything Hyo do because we live in the communities that their airports serve. And had we been involved in it from the beginning, it might not have developed into the mess that it is if they'd have actually listened to us, which they refused to do. So, you know, I have a problem with Hyo management still being the same people, still making the same bad decisions, and still trying to run a project. And I hope they've learned their lesson. And as Prospect said, I hope that they will work and listen to the people rather than continue bullheaded as they have done.
Thank you.
You know, we've achieved an awful lot in this. We've managed to, you know, the programme, the ATMS programme was basically dissolved. There's nothing much left of it. So that served our purpose. But I think it would have failed anyway, purely on cost, without us even intervening.
Thank you very much.
Look, we've received quite strong representation from Hyo that the change, and we will be meeting them on the 18th of May, so we will be able to put some of the points you've raised directly to them, but that this change is not window dressing, that it is for whatever motivation, and we can chase that issue, that this is not simply a cover in order to bring back the proposal that has now been set aside again in 5 years' time. That has been quite robustly positioned in the paper that we've received from them. Do you, as petitioners, accept that?
Well, I actually hoped that by asking the questions in the way I did, that they would come back in a robust way and make it very clear that they're not going to revisit this, because it was still a bit vague. They still wanted to have a remote tower at Inverness, for example, which couldn't see the reason why. So, yes, I think I probably do accept, we probably accept now that they're not going to go ahead with ATMS as they said. So, we've achieved a lot, but most of it's collapsed. I mean, they still seem to want to have controlled airspace at some of the airports and radar. That's fair enough. They've withdrawn the applications to the Civil Aviation for the authority for the airspace changes. So I don't know, you know, we will find out when they've redrawn ATMS where they intend to go. But when they come up with their plan, you know, please try and run it by the communities and make it very public what the plan is and ask for our input on whether or not we think it's okay.
Okay, thank you. Do any of my colleagues, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. You've talked about this morning the openness and honesty in this whole process, and it's quite evident from your concerns you've raised and the community feeling that they have not been listened to and have not had the impact that they wanted out of this whole process. So you talked about lessons being learned, and you hope that is the case, but how And where do you see that the management handled the concerns that were expressed by the proposal initially? Were they completely flawed from the beginning? Or was there any areas within what they produced that had the potential and the opportunity to be seen as open to the community and willing to anticipate that process?
Well, basically every single point that we ever raised initially was rebutted with the reply that HMS is the only way forward. There are no other ways. Without it, nothing else can be done. So we must do it. The island's impact assessment was very negative, for just about the effects on all of the islands. They still just said, all we need to do is mitigate. You know, they said we just need to mitigate this rather than actually address the problems. There was just constant rebuttal of anything and everything that we said, from a staff level right the way through to MPs, MSPs. You know, it's all been in the newspapers. It's all been all over the place. It's all in the evidence submitted. And then there was a sudden change. Yes, modernisation, ATMS modernisation. It would be extremely useful to have radar or some form of surveillance at the airports. But taking people out of the airports was a step too far. I can remember when I worked for HIAL, myself and colleagues laying out our concerns and being told, you know, we would raise safety concerns and we were told it was a matter of opinion. So I left. I couldn't take it anymore because they won't listen. What's the point of that? And then when you get a culture that doesn't listen, you stop raising concerns, and that's a worry. But from a community level, I think, you know, Benbecula Community Council did an extremely good thing. But even they're not, you know, there's no word yet on exactly whether or not Benbecula air traffic is definitely going to stay. It seems to be the story is that Benbecula air traffic will stay, which it should, and the same with Wick. But we need something concrete about that.
I mean, you know, you mentioned that the opportunities that the community have had, and I do believe that the community needs to be congratulated on their endeavours, because they really have highlighted this, and you've worked along with politicians and other groups within the community just to ensure that this was kept very live. And I think that has been to your credit. But what do you want to see different? What do you want to see them trying to achieve if they come back, and they are going to come back with something for the future?
Well, it comes down, basically, there's been quite an outcry saying, can we not have people who live in the communities on the boards of, like, organisations like HIAL and CalMAC? Because then, if you have people that live in the community, interact with the community, and have feedback from that community, as you do with your MSPs, you know, your MPs, you can feed directly in. People who are remote don't understand what we're going through. As I say, HIAL, you know, we've got all the airports are run as individual airports, but they need to have some sort of feedback from the customers about, you know, if HIAL decide to make a change, they need to actually examine whether that change is going to be for the good or the bad. How they go about doing that, it's difficult to say, but, you know, put it in the local papers, make some sort of announcement. All I know is that everything they've done has just been stonewall. We're doing this and we don't care what you say. And quite often the people who live in the communities are the staff that work at the airport. Well, the people that work at the airport are the best sort of measure of how the community feeling is. And they need, HIAL just need to listen to what their staff say. And I fear that they still don't. You know, if I was to go to my airport manager and say, this is all a complete shambles, and we actually got the board in at Kirkwall, spoke to them directly and said, this will never work as you want it to, it's a mess. We spoke to them face to face and they just, yeah, okay, we'll look into it, and continued anyway. What are you meant to do?
Okay, and a final question from Fergus Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ms Henson. I've just joined this committee recently, so please forgive me if this question is covering ground that may already have been covered in the history of the petition thus far. But in asking for an independent assessment, I wanted just to get a sense of who you think could conduct such an assessment and how that person or persons might be appointed. And the reason I ask is this, that it does seem to me that the Civil Aviation Authority have, if you like, that role of conducting a proper assessment of any proposal, and given that they are the statutory body in the UK charged with responsibility to regulate air safety, and given the critical importance of that function, it doesn't seem to me to be immediately obvious who else, other than the CAA, could really be expected to carry out an assessment of something which, at the end of the day, is designed to protect people against air accidents, which would almost certainly result in fatalities. So I just wanted to get a sense, Mr. Henderson, of who and how you think an independent assessment, were it to be carried out, could be carried out in practice.
Well, the CAA oversee the rules and regulations regarding aviation. So, yes, when it comes down to safety, they're the ultimate arbiter. When it comes to throwing money at a project that was never going to work, which is funded by the taxpayer, which was damaging to communities, which was run by an organisation that refused to listen to its own staff concerns, then I suspect that somebody in government, because government funds HIAL and Transport Scotland funds HIAL, somebody in government needs to look at just how these decisions are made regarding the services that are provided at airports and the ideas that are bandied about. I mean, it's not so much, yes, everything that HIAL comes up with is, you know, there's an aviation safety aspect to it, but centralising staff to Inverness, deciding to take over an existing radar contract from the National Air Traffic Service at Sunbury, which has run reliably for decades, and then find that they can't even staff it and they're a year behind schedule. You know, I mean, these are managerial tasks which seem to be badly handled. The HIAL board are meant to examine the management of HIAL and pull them up on mistakes they've made. Well, obviously, the HIAL board just rubber stamp stuff. They have done all along. They don't seem to understand the things that they're signing off.
I got the gist of that, and it's more a question of the finance and the managerial aspects of how HIAL have failed, as you would see it, so thus far.
Yes.
Is it, just to be clear, somebody in the Scottish Government that should carry out this independent assessment, in your view?
I believe so, because, you know, £9 million been chucked down the drain on something that we said all along wouldn't work in the way they wanted it to. And we were just told it's the only way. It's my way or the highway, basically, you know, and that's not a way to run an organisation.
Thank you very much. And thank you very much, Mr. Henderson. That's been very helpful. Thanks for your persistence in pursuing the petition. And we will be seeing HIAL on the 18th of May, so we'll be able to take forward some of the specific questions you've asked and pursue them with them on that date. But thank you very much for your time this morning. And I now suspend the committee for a few moments. Quite set. Hello again, welcome back, and we now move on to our second witness this morning in relation to PE 1804 on the Hyle plans. And I'm delighted to welcome David Avery from Prospect, whose name has been referred to and brought up in evidence on numerous occasions in our deliberations. So it's you're very welcome to be with us this morning. And we've read your most recent, or at least Prospect's most recent response to events in our papers ahead of this morning's session. So I'm going to move straight into questions, if I may, and ask Paul Sweeney to start.
Thank you, Convener. Welcome, Mr. Avery, to the committee, and thanks for your submission so far on behalf of your members in Hyle. We just wanted to kick off by asking how confident are you that the arrangements for development of a new air traffic control strategy will produce results that are acceptable to your members in Hyle?
I mean, I'm reasonably confident the new direction is far more palatable than where we were before. It's still not, it wasn't members' preferred choice. They would still have preferred local deployment. However, this did achieve all of our goals around protecting local jobs, preventing the downgrades of two airports, and we have assurances that, you know, for at least 5 years that will be the case, which, if you consider it's a government body, they have ministerial direction, 5 years is a reasonable guarantee of no change. Whether or not Hyle are able to deliver, I am more hopeful they are able to deliver this system than the previous one. This is replicating what they already have in Sumbra, what they've already had in Sumbra for decades. It's established technology, it's established procedures in a way that what they were proposing with their remote towers project simply wasn't. So I think this has is far simpler, it's far more likely to be delivered. It's still not easy, but I think it still has a better chance of delivery than their previous proposals.
Thanks for that. We did note in your letter to the committee on the 7th of March this year, the working groups on the future of air traffic control at Wick and Benbecula in particular, the working groups weren't yet to be established. Have you had any further information about whether there's progress on that? And would you like to see that happen? Is there a need for that?
So I'm pleased to confirm that actually the working groups haven't been set up because they haven't been needed. Right. The company's given us the same assurance for both those airports that there will be no downgrade of service for at least 5 years, at which point there will be a review, and a review looking at with an open mind rather than a review with an aim to justify a decision. And that's been, again, the goal that members have been seeking. They're not the same airport. They have very different communities, very different needs. And at no point, I mean, they are going to be two separate reviews, because I think it's not necessarily the same solution for the two airports in the long term.
I think the main...
Ask, when did that change of view in relation to Bembeck, when was that confirmed? Because that's quite recent and not something I think that we were aware of from our papers.
Yes, so it was subsequent to the last submission that was made. I don't have the exact date. Bembecula, I think, may have been about 4 weeks ago. Wick is very recent, within the last week.
Okay, thank you. Sorry.
No problem, Convener. I think the main consideration for a lot of people has been safety, aviation safety, in relation to these changes. What is your union's position on what the implications of these changes will be in future traffic control for aviation safety?
So our view has always been that radar is a welcome improvement. It's a vital safety tool for any controlled airspace with any scheduled commercial traffic. It would provide an improved safety service. It would also potentially open up markets to other airlines who aren't prepared to fly without radar, all of which we see as a positive. Controlled airspace, again, is welcome. There is acceptance that were those two things to be done, that they would need to, that you could then phase out procedural control. And again, that isn't something the members are opposed to, assuming it is done in the right way and done in a safe way. So there has always been an aim to seek to make safety improvements. Where we disagreed was how Hyle were intending to do it, and ultimately whether or not remote towers would bring its own set of problems with it.
Thanks very much.
Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Avery. I wonder if I could ask you, do you think there are any particular lessons that could be learned by Hyle about the way that they've handled this whole thing from your perspective?
Absolutely. Involvement of staff, involvement of communities, I think being more sceptical of consultants, all of which are lessons I hope Heil and indeed other organisations have learnt. I've been very critical of how Heil kicked off this project without public consultation, very little staff consultation and the views of staff frankly disregarded, the justification of the case based on the report of one consultant, which wasn't the direction the rest of the industry was moving. We've had no major remote towers announced in the way that Heil was intending to do them anywhere else in the UK in the last 5 years. So their original view that they were at the bow wave of a tide of change is just clearly not the case. This project has never been subject to public consultation. I think it absolutely is a major change in service. It's a major change in the way that air traffic would be delivered, and I think it still should be. I think the time to do that would be at the point to which Transport Scotland's Infrastructure Board have approved the case.
I mean, obviously, as I said before, this petition has quite a long history, and I've just come into this, although I've been aware and following matters. But plainly, progress has been made, partly as a result of the work that Prospect have done and the engagement that, of MSPs and of petitioners, indeed. So progress has been made. Do you now feel that that progress covers some of the defects, as you would see it, that you've just described? In other words, are you confident now that going into the future that Heil will listen to staff more, will engage with communities more, because you've been, as I understand it, in the thick of it?
I'm hopeful that's the case. They are involving staff far more in the current phase of the project. I'm not particularly citing on community engagement. Currently, the work is of a pretty technical nature, rather than the kind of work you would want to take out to communities for having a discussion. But that will come in the future. I mean, particularly questions around schedule, deployment, staffing levels, opening hours, are all questions which I think communities would rightly want to have a view on.
Yeah. These are hugely important to all the islands served by Heil and lifeline services in many cases, I guess. What about the financial side? Do you have an idea about how much Heil has spent on the now aborted air traffic management strategy?
No more than what is in the public domain. So the papers I see don't include commercially in confidence numbers, and I wouldn't be able to discuss those. I would suggest that needs to be put to Heil.
Okay. Do you think that these should be made public, or are there good reasons why that should not be the case?
I think it's not for me as a union to say whether or not they should or shouldn't. It's a public project. I think there has been a significant expenditure on this. I think it is worth looking into some of the decisions which have taken us to this point, and that would include the costs incurred.
Hmm. And just finally, I mean, if that is the case and that should be looked into, you heard from the petitioner that who I think confirmed that he felt it should be the Scottish Government that should take charge of that analysis, that independent analysis, which surprised me a little bit because I'd thought that perhaps what was envisaged by the petitioner was an individual independent, not only of Heil, but the Scottish Government. But be that as it may, if you think that this should be analysed and that the costs incurred today should be studied, do you have an idea about who the right person or the right body to do that work would be?
So I've only thought about it recently, having listened to Peter's evidence. My view would probably be Audit Scotland. I think you don't need to be an aviation expert to look at the problems within this project. I'm not an aviation expert. I'm professionally a scientist. But I've learned a lot having done 5 years of dealing with this project. But the issues that the specialist issues, those relating to IT, air traffic engineering, air traffic control and so on, those you can seek advice from various learned sources. The looking into the questions around decision making, around finance, around confidence and risk and management of risk, I think these are the kind of questions which Audit Scotland are professionally able to deal with.
That's very helpful. And of course, after this committee, if you have further thoughts, because yeah, these questions are being sprung on you, but if you have further thoughts, you'd be very keen to receive them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Ewing. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Mr Raby, you talk about the lack of communication and the lack of consultation in this whole process as to what was happening with the staff in the communities. So can I ask about sort of industrial relations and how that is progressing and what impact, that the handling of this whole affair has had on industrial relations with reference to High Island and your organisation?
I mean, High Island is a very different organisation to almost any other one I deal with, and it always has been. I mean, I've been involved with them for 7 years, so significant time before this. Indeed, my predecessor expressed the same view, and he dealt with them for far longer. They're the only airport, the only ANSP under public ownership in the manner they are. So they're not analogous to Prestwick or NATS, which are run as private companies. They are run as a public body. But they are then not like any of the other public bodies because they have significant commercial elements, very highly operational staff. Their aim is to achieve a service delivery in a way that most other public bodies don't. So they're already a difficult company to deal with because of those challenges. Industrial relations have been strained, but you know, we've never fallen out. We've never stopped talking. We've always had good discussions, even through the industrial action periods. And I am hopeful that with the new engagement with staff, that there will be more involvement in staff in decision-making, not just within air traffic, but across the board within HIAL.
And from that, you know, you talked about lessons being learned in this whole process, but it's vitally important that lessons are learned as to how to manage the staff and the industrial relations that will take place in the future. What would you like to see HIAL trying to achieve to ensure that that does become a reality?
So I would like them to, whenever making any decisions which relate to staffing or service delivery, involve their staff at whatever level. So whether or not that's a change of opening hours or a change in a security protocol or something big like air traffic control changes, that the staff who are involved in delivery of service are actually involved in those decisions, that the communities are involved, that there aren't things just sprung on them as this is now what we are going to do. I'm hopeful that that change will happen, but it's a large organisation, it's a very difficult organisation, just the disparate nature of multiple airports. So it's not going to happen overnight.
Thank you, Convener.
Mr. Avery, the previous witness, we were exploring what's brought about the change of view in HIAL. And he was sceptical that it was our investigation into these matters or our representations or your representations, indeed, and that it was all down to a realisation that the costs involved in all of this were no longer sustainable. What do you think the cornerstone of their change of approach has been?
Well, I have to say, I wasn't inclined to look gift horses in the mouth and question their motivations when they came to us for a discussion on a more positive note, given the previous 5 years. Where there had been no discussion about strategic direction. I think it probably isn't one thing. And I hope that the board's view on why a change was necessary, why a change in direction was necessary, wasn't down to any one factor. I think it was a combination of the work of this committee, the industrial action from staff, the ANZ impact assessment, the constant negative stories about HIAL. I mean, they were struggling to get any positive media coverage about other things they were doing because this was drowning them out, and you know, costs, and that the project was still not going anywhere. And ultimately, it is very hard to implement a project like this without the buy-in of staff.
Okay, thank you. Now, I'm going to invite our two parliamentary colleagues who've joined us this morning and have been with us at various stages during our consideration of this petition over an extended period, if they would like to ask anything in particular of you. Liam MacArthur, have you agreed between you who's going first? Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. And it was really just a point of clarification. I think Prospect have worked really well on this, and I'm really pleased we are where we are and making progress. But we talked about replicating Sumbra, and I know Peter Henderson, the petitioner, had some concerns about what might happen in Sumbra, i.e. the radar would be centralised to Inverness. Does that have staffing implications, and do you see issues with that?
So there are staff, as Peter alluded to, they have hired staff for Sumbra in Inverness to undertake that, who are working on delivering that radar service. It's being delivered what's called a so-called greenfield radar, so as if you never had it before, because they aren't transferring any of the staff or procedures from NATS. So it's being done almost from scratch. And that isn't an easy thing to do. The regulator is quite rightly taking a significant interest. They may well need more staff than they currently have. And to an extent, it's going to take the time it's going to take. I still think it's a far more achievable prospect than the previous remote towers proposition. This is at least replicating something that Heil has already done. So from the point of view of the controllers in Sumbra, they don't have to learn new procedures. They're handing over to another provider, this time Inverness rather than Aberdeen. But for them, there won't be a significant change. And that is far easier to manage than what would have happened had they been centralising both the tower and the radar.
So the radar at Sumbra is currently operated from Aberdeen by NATS, is that right? There's nobody based in Sumbra that's not got a jobs implication for Shetland at all?
No, none at all. The staff who are in Sumbra will remain, the roles will remain as they are. And as I understand it, the roles in Aberdeen can be redeployed to other work within NATS. They have other work they would like to move them onto when the Heil contract has ended.
Thank you.
And Liam MacArthur.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think I'll make a couple of observations before turning to the issue that Rhoda was just pressing with Mr Avery. I still can't really get my head around the fact that we were told for years by Heil management that this was the only show in town, this was the only credible option. They backed off this much later in the day than I and many others would have hoped, and I think Mr Avery's probably fairly fair in his assessment that this is a result of a number of factors, but the cost and deliverability was always under serious question, and I think that may well have driven them back to the negotiating table. But there has been no reckoning with those that marched us up that hill and have marched us back down again. And I think the point made earlier about Audit Scotland casting their eyes over this seems to me entirely sensible and reasonable. The cost is one component of this. Some of it is around the way that decisions were made. But actually the cost to the public purse, I think, is a very, very real concern. I've had discussions with Audit Scotland in the past who suggested that this is more a matter for Transport Scotland to deal with. But in a sense, they've got skin in the game with the responsibility they have for Heil. So I would certainly be keen to understand the extent to which Audit Scotland could provide a degree of satisfaction that due process was followed and that public monies were not needlessly wasted, as it would appear to be the case at HATS. I think in relation to the centralised radar that Mr Henderson was talking about and Rhoda was just pursuing there do appear to be similar, different but similar concerns now being raised. We heard from Mr Henderson earlier about those, and this seems to me to fall into the same category of a review or a decision that is predetermined, and that Heil is now asking, it does appear to be consulting more, but is asking how do we deliver what we've already determined we are going to deliver. And I just wonder whether or not that there isn't some work to be done to get Heil to almost go back to first principles. Yes, they may have delivered this. This is not completely alien to them. But if the concerns that Mr Henderson was raising previously are legitimate and they seem to me to be borne out by evidence, then I would hope that this committee and Prospect in its discussions with Heil might be able to persuade Heil to go back to first principles and determine whether or not a centralised model for radar surveillance is any more practical and in the interests of the island communities that rely on these lifeline services. And I just wonder whether Mr Avery agrees with that, whether that is an approach that Prospect may be able to carry forward in terms of their own negotiations.
Thank you, Mr Avery.
So members' preferred model was a local deployment, but they've agreed to this remote system from Inverness. My understanding, bear in mind I'm not a controller, my understanding is in terms of technical feasibility, delivering radar from Inverness versus living radar from a room down the stairs in Sunborough Tower are not wildly different. The questions you would have to ask around procedure, around the validation of staff, around training, are largely the same, and that the challenges HAR would face doing a greenfield radar installation if they were doing it in Sunborough or indeed any other airport, on site versus remotely, are the same challenges that they would face in either circumstance. As a union, we don't particularly have a view on whether or not those jobs are better in Inverness or in Sunborough or indeed in Aberdeen where they currently are based. They're all areas where it's prospect membership, and I wouldn't want to speculate about which was better than another. So I don't particularly have a view on that. I think it is highlighting that this greenfield radar application is genuinely a difficult thing to do. HAL only have one radar base. It's Inverness Airport currently. Inverness is short-staffed. They can't share the experience of those controllers into the project. It is not an easy thing to do to deliver this service, but it is a doable challenge and a far more doable challenge than the one they'd previously embarked on. So I wouldn't particularly take a view on that. If I can just expand on the Audit Scotland point, my previous industry relations works I've done involved the creation of Marine Scotland, and I remember Audit Scotland did audit the creation of Marine Scotland when it was finished and did provide insights onto lessons which can be learned from machinery of government changes. I do think they're probably the appropriate body to look at it. As Liam has said, Transport Scotland ultimately are involved in decision-making in HAL. They sit on the board. They ultimately decide. They will sign off or not the changes to this project. So I'm not sure they're necessarily in a position to audit themselves.
OK, thank you. And can I ask just a final question of you, I suppose. Do Prospect retain confidence in HAL and its existing board?
We have never put the question to our members of whether they have or do not have confidence in HAL and its board. And I wouldn't want to speculate how they would vote were we to put that question to them.
So that's one gift horse you are prepared to look in the mouth. OK. Thank you very much. That's been extremely useful and very helpful. Thank you. Just before, I think, colleagues, we will probably consider this evidence afresh after we've met with HAL. Liam MacArthur made some general comments in addition to the point that we put to Mr Avery. Rhoda Grant, is there any general comment you would like just to add, since you made a rather specific question? I just wonder if there was any general comment you would like us to bear in mind before I draw this particular session to an end.
Well, I think when you're speaking to HAL, it's about community involvement. Having spoken with Prospect members and the like, they seem happier with their involvement at the moment. But as we heard from Peter Henderson, he's quite concerned about the community involvement, and he's there representing the community, albeit as a previous employee. But we need to get everybody on side. I think this is important enough that we need to make sure whatever comes forward from the discussions that are now having as buy-in from everybody, and that everybody has confidence in the system put in place.
Thank you very much. Liam McCarvey, a final point?
Just a final point. I mean, just following up from what David said there about not necessarily having a particular concern about where the radar surveillance jobs are based, and I can understand that the overall total, the fact that those jobs are secure, well-paid, etc., training's in place, etc., are the primary concerns. I think for HAL and those as representatives of the different communities served by HAL, we do have an interest in where those jobs are based. And if there aren't overwhelming arguments for why they need to be based centrally, as is proposed, rather than dispersed around the network, I think HAL needs to explain why that is, and that there almost should be an expectation that as far as possible, HAL and other public bodies are dispersing jobs around the region. But I think Peter Henderson also set out some real concerns about the practicability of what's been proposed.
And as that flag is run up the mast, I will draw this particular evidence session to a conclusion. Thank you all very much, and we just suspend briefly. Our next consideration is of petition number 1812, protecting Scotland's remaining ancient, native and semi-native woodlands and woodland floors. Lodged by Audrey Baird and Fiona Baker, we've taken considerable evidence on this petition, which calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to deliver world-leading legislation giving Scotland's remaining fragments of ancient, native and semi-native woodlands and woodland floors full legal protection. We last considered it on the 23rd of March, when we took evidence from the Minister for Environment and Land Reform, Mary McCallum, and Doug Howison from Scottish Forestry. And that followed on from the evidence that members will recall we heard from the petitioners themselves on March the 9th, and a round table of Nature Scot, Woodland Trust Scotland, Scottish Forestry, Confor and the RSPB. The Minister indicated that work would be underway in this summer to develop the Register of Ancient Woodlands, and the Minister remains open-minded on how existing protections and enforcement measures could be improved. During the most recent meeting, we heard about about the importance of ancient woodland for biodiversity and carbon capture. We also explored how forestry standards are currently enforced and what needs to happen to ensure the continued protection of ancient and native woodlands. We agreed to reflect on the evidence that we had heard and to consider our next steps this morning. So I wonder, colleagues, what we might do next. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I would like to undertake to visit one of the ancient woodlands, native woodlands, just to see what the problems are, but also, just because shortly the experience is a certain MSP and a complaint by constituents on trees that were removed by, which were protected by a TPO order, and a response from Fife Council, and I will put on record that it was not in the public's interest to prosecute, I would like to write to all the local authorities in Scotland to see how many prosecutions they've had under TPO protection orders for native woodland or for trees in the area, just to see what response we could get.
Thank you. Colleagues, in the first instance, did anybody else have any suggestions to make? No, we've previously indicated that we might like to undertake a site visit, and I just want to formally conclude that we would like to do that. And David Torrance's second point, I think, is well made. I mean, the evidence we received from the Minister was that additional legal protections aren't necessary because there are protections in place. But as is often the case, we now, I think, sensibly might want to inquire as to whether these are being used to protect. Is writing to local authorities, we're content to proceed on that basis? Yeah, thank you very much.
Would it be an idea to write to Scottish Forestry as well? Because I do think they've got various enforcement responsibilities in respect of inappropriate felling, which I think was one of the issues raised.
Yeah, very happy to do that too. Thank you very much. Paul Sweeney?
Convener, just that I remember the petitioners presented a particular case study. I might be interested to visit that location to see the particular facts on the ground for looking at a visit to a location.
Yeah. Well, I think that we were going to get some recommendations from the organisations we're going to in order that we can actually... I don't think we'd want to find that we're in deepest, darkest hinterlands on a Wednesday morning, abandoned in the forest with our compass. I'm not quite sure where we would end up. But, yes, very much so. Thank you. Petition number 1837, provide clear direction and investment for autism support. This petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to clarify how autistic people who do not have a learning disability, and that's actually the key, or a mental disorder, can access support, and how we can allocate investment for autism support teams in every authority of health and care in Scotland. We were particularly interested when we wrote to the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care on the 17th of November to find out whether the proposed Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill would address the petitioner's concerns, and in the interim, which support measures will be put in place for individuals who have autism but who do not have a learning disability or mental illness, and how the Minister intended to collect and disseminate examples of good practice. The Minister provided examples of current work and recent pilots, all of which are set out in full in the members' papers. And the Minister indicated that should a new commissioner be created via the proposed legislation, then detailed consideration would be required as to what their powers and duties should be. In the meantime, the Scottish Government plans to collate and analyse good practice amongst health and social care partnerships. The petitioners responded, saying that the Minister's submission did not explain specifically, again, where autistic people who do not have a learning disability or mental health issue can access support. And he notes that the pilot projects mentioned are time-limited and area-specific. Post-diagnostic support is required on a lifelong basis, not just at the point of diagnosis, and that this petition is due to be discussed at the next Chief Social Work Officer Committee taking place this month. I wonder if colleagues have any proposals. I mean, I would like to suggest that those very points are ones that we might go back to the Minister again, because when the Minister, I think, is suggesting that any commission or commissioner, their powers and duties would be reviewed, it may be that the Minister is suggesting that within that framework, the responsibility for the petitioner's particular objective might be allocated, but that's not actually said, and so I would be quite happy to go back to the Minister and say, look, very specifically again in relation to the petitioner's concern for those who do not have a learning disability or a mental health issue, what is proposed or where do they go? Are we content on that basis? Thank you. Next is petition number 1845, which is to advocate the healthcare needs of rural Scotland, lodged by Gordon Baird on behalf of Galloway Community Hospital Action Group. I think Rhoda Grant is joining us again for this petition. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create an agency to ensure that health boards offer fair and reasonable management of rural and remote healthcare issues. Now, we last discussed this on 8th of September when we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, the Remote and Rural General Practice Short Life Working Group, as well as to the rural health boards. We've received various submissions from stakeholders, and colleagues will have seen a late submission from Finlay Carson MSP, which have all been shared. The chair of the Remote and Rural General Practice Working Group highlights its recent report and the recommendation to establish a national centre of excellence for remote and rural health care, health and social care. Work is currently underway on implementing this recommendation, including exploring the potential role of Rural Health Commissioner, a position which has been successfully established in Australia. The responses from NHS Scotland and Orkney and NHS Grampian provide information of their respective approaches to public engagement. We've also received a further submission from our petitioner, which is included in full members' papers, and a submission from Claire Fleming in support of the petition. Rhoda Grant, is there anything you'd like to say just before we come to a view as to what we might do next?
I still have a huge number of concerns about rural healthcare, and I think what's quite concerning is the centre of excellence is still being defined and the nature of it is being looked at. So we are a long way from having that rural centre of excellence. Meanwhile, in my own area, UHI have had fast-track midwife training removed from them, and we know there is a huge lack of staff. And if I again just refer to the Highlands and Islands, maternity care is a big, big issue. The maternity unit in Caithness was downgraded to a midwife-led unit. The same thing has happened in Dr. Gray's and Elgin, which are quite different places. Caithness obviously goes to Raigmore and Inverness, and there is discussions and indeed agreement that at some point in the future, Murray births will go to Inverness, certainly for a period of time. Now, there are not enough staff in Raigmore Hospital in Inverness to deal with the births. They've got far less, taking on more. What we need is people in the communities, because the submission from the community in Caithness, we're talking about the distances people have to travel. So at the moment, I'm taking part in a group in Caithness looking at the cost of living and the impact that's having, especially fuel costs. But it was put to me that people are getting 15 pence a mile, with the first £10 being top sliced off that for travelling to Raigmore. Now, I wrote to NHS Highland, they've increased that by a couple of pence a mile in recognition of fuel costs, which are worse in rural areas. But that presupposes you have a car and that you can afford to put fuel in it. And it takes no account of rural deprivation. And I think the point was made in one of your submissions that people seem to think that this is a lifestyle choice. You move to a rural area, to a leafy suburb, and it's lovely. And if you're going to do that, you have to accept that you're not going to get an accident, an emergency around every corner. Everyone knows that, but we're talking about people who have been born and brought up in deprived communities in those areas being expected to travel hundreds of miles to achieve healthcare. On top of that, with COVID, there are restrictions to accessing a hospital, even during childbirth. And in Inverness, in the height of the summer, even budget hotels are about £400 a room. If you're on a limited income, you can't be there. There is no way you can be there with a loved one in hospital. It has huge implications for families, and indeed it has huge implications for people accessing healthcare for themselves, because there is a cost attached to it and we need to do better. So really to urge you to keep this petition open and to really push that instead of getting crumbs off the table, rural areas are looked at as a case in point and how we supply them with the health services they need. And it doesn't depend on the wealth of the people trying to access those health services as well.
Thank you very much, Rhoda Grant. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I would definitely like to keep this petition open, and I know my colleague, Emma Harper, has been working with the petitioner, Gordon Baird, but before we invite a petitioner to give evidence before us, I wonder if we could check with the Health and Sport Committee, because there's two petitions very similar here, if there's anything like that in their work programme.
Implicit in that is that we maybe are now at a time,
yes,
in other circumstances where we would hear from the petitioner. So are we happy to, in principle, say that we would now like to hear from the petitioner, but just check to establish whether there is any work programme issue with a partner committee? Agreed? Alexander Stewart, were you going to say something more?
I just agree with that, Convener, because I think it's vitally important now that, as Rhoda Grant has indicated, that because it is so sparse and it's postcode lottery nearly across the location, it would be useful now to get the petitioner in to give evidence on the process as to where we are taking it and how it will progress. So I would concur with that, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Petition number 1862, to introduce community representation on boards of public organisations delivering lifeline services to island communities. This petition has been lodged by Rona Mackay, Angus Campbell and Naomi Bremer on behalf of the Uist Economic Task Force. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce community representation on boards of public organisations delivering lifeline services to island communities in keeping with the Islands Scotland Act 2018. We last considered this on February the 2nd when we agreed to write to the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands. I'm pleased to say that since that meeting, when we have received a response from the Minister for Transport, which outlines the process for agreeing who should sit on the selection panel for each public body recruitment exercise, the Minister has indicated that the current process involves a selection panel making recommendations to the Minister on all aspects of the recruitment exercise, including what the key criteria for each vacant position should be. The Minister has therefore indicated that she does not believe the legislative change is required. So, having outlined how this will now proceed, colleagues, does anyone have any suggestions to make? Would we like to hear potentially now from the Minister and from the petitioners, just to see whether or not we believe this is going to resolve issues, or are we satisfied with the Minister's response?
I would suggest that we have the Minister convener. I think that's important. I mean, the response does cover some aspects, but I do think there is more that can be teased out.
Are we agreed then, colleagues? We are. Thank you very much. Petition number 1867, establish a new national qualification for British Sign Language. And I also highlight that this is currently available to watch on the Parliament's channel with the Scottish Parliament's BSL channel for this particular consideration of this petition this morning. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to encourage the Scottish Qualifications, the Qualifications Authority, the SQA, to establish a national qualification in British Sign Language, BSL, at SCQF Level 2. Again, we last considered this on the 2nd of February, when we agreed to write to the Scottish Government, the SQA, Deaf Action Inquire, the National Deaf Children's Society Scotland, the Scottish Children's Services Coalition. We've now received detailed responses from the SQA and the Scottish Government, clarifying their processes. The Scottish the Qualifications Authority response noted that assessment of demand is based on the number of learners that have been entered by schools for existing range of qualifications. The SQA and Scottish Government hold joint responsibility for the development of new and or revised national qualifications. The response of the Scottish Government notes that schools have broad discretion in determining which additional languages to offer. And while there is currently no national qualification for BSL, there is nothing in policy to prevent schools teaching it from as early as primary one. Members may wish to note that we have also received submissions from Children Scotland and Deaf Action. And I did note in the response we received from the SQA that it is often the case that support for a qualification amongst those who are lobbying for it is not always reflective or then matched by the demand secured. And, you know, I think that is a reasonable point to make. Do members have any comments or suggestions as to how we might proceed again this morning? David Torrance, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. To write to Derek Todd at the Scottish Sensory Hub, who's the lead BSL consultant with the Alliance. If the committee would like to do that.
I think we might then write to Mr. Todd. I mean, he's Alliance do seem to potentially have something to offer to this consideration. Are we agreed? We are. Thank you. Petition number 1890, to find solutions to recruitment and training challenges for rural healthcare in Scotland. Rhoda Grant was going to join us, but I think has now just made the points that she might have wished to in relation to the previous petition we were considering on rural healthcare. This has been lodged by Maria Aitken on behalf of Caithness Health Action Team and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to find ways to provide localised training and recruit and retain healthcare staff in difficult-to-recruit positions in Scotland. We've also received a written submission from Edward Mountain, which has been circulated to members in advance of the meeting. And at our last consideration of this position, we agreed to seek NHS Highlands' views. They have responded and outlined a number of key challenges for rural healthcare in Scotland and the steps being taken to address these, and they include local accommodation shortages and lack of affordable housing, challenges in attracting people to social care roles, and an ageing workforce. Familiar challenges indeed. Members will recall that the last time we considered this position, we agreed to consider it alongside Petition 1845, and we had talked about taking oral evidence at a future meeting. Are members content, as we agreed to with the petition with which it's partnered, to invite the petitioners to take to provide evidence at a future meeting? Are we agreed? Thank you. Petition number 1909. To remove the gender-based crime domestic abuse narrative and to make it gender neutral and equal. This petition was lodged by William Wright and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to make domestic abuse policies, guidance, agendas and practices gender neutral. To introduce equal domestic abuse provision and funding for everyone in Scotland, regardless of any protected characteristic. And to ensure all domestic abuse joint protocol guidance, policies and practice for Police Scotland and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service are gender neutral. At the last consideration of this petition, we agreed to write to stakeholders to seek their reviews. And we've now received submissions from the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, from Police Scotland, from Assist, the Minister for Equalities and Older People, the petitioner and AMIS, AMIS, and a male domestic abuse charity operating a helpline service across Scotland. Now, these submissions have been shared in full ahead of the meeting. The key points raised include the current definition of domestic abuse includes abuse of male victims by female perpetrators. Police Scotland states there is no variance in the level of service a victim will receive regardless of their sex or gender. The Minister for Equalities and Older People states that the Scottish Government will engage and consult on a national strategy on ending intimate and sexual violence against men in September of this year. And ASSIST states that a gendered approach is important in recognising that men and women may require different services and approaches. AMIS recommends that instead of making domestic abuse approaches gender neutral, they should be gender inclusive and measures should be proportionate instead of equal. They raise concerns that by sharing overall funding for services that support men and women, there is a misleading impression that male services are then adequately funded. That also they also advocate that for revised gender-informed training for those in the justice system. The petitioner's most recent submission provides further information about his own experiences as a male victim of domestic abuse. He also suggests several other stakeholders the committee may wish to hear from. So, quite a lot for us to consider, and I wonder if colleagues have any suggestions they would like to make, having done so. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, for that. To write to the Scottish Government to ask how a petitioner can engage with the development of a national strategy and end intimate and sexual violence against men and boys, I think we should write to Police Scotland as well to see their approach to gender-informed domestic abuse training. And to write to the stakeholders outlined in the petitioner's recent submission, if that's okay with the committee.
Are the committee content? I mean, I think particularly to the petitioner, given that this national strategy is going to be established with a view to taking considerations from September this year. So I think that would be very useful for them to contribute to that. Are we all content? We are. Petition number 1911... Review of Human Tissue Scotland Act 2006 as it relates to post-mortems. This is a petition lodged by Anne McNair, and the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the Human Tissue Scotland Act 2006 and the relevant guidance to ensure that all post-mortems can only be carried out with the permission of the next of kin, do not routinely remove brains, and offer tissues and samples to next of kin as a matter of course. We are hoping that Monica Lennon might join us, but she has been delayed, but she may well join us as we continue our consideration. I'd like to start by reminding members about the very difficult circumstances in which the petitioner brings us the petition. The petitioner's child died suddenly and underwent a post-mortem that was much more extensive in nature than the petitioner had originally thought it would be. Now, the committee last considered this petition on the 1st of December 21 and heard that in England and Wales, next of kin are given a choice about how they would like the small tissue samples to be handled. And the committee therefore agreed to write to the Scottish Government and the Royal College of Pathologists. Now, we've received detailed responses to that correspondence. The Scottish Government responded in consultation with the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service. And they explained that if tissue samples are returned to next of kin, it may impair their ability to investigate the circumstance surrounding a death or to establish a definitive cause of death. The Royal College of Pathologists suggests that returning tissue samples would provide only a marginal gain and would then need to be traded off against further complexities in authorisation and consent. And those complexities are listed in their submission. The petitioner's own recent submission reiterates the key points of her petition, expressing that being told that samples of her child belong to no particular person is the cruelest thing she'd ever heard. On the issue of invasive postmortems, the petitioner suggests that an alternative would be to use a scanner, and this provides results that are more than 99% accurate. The committee has also received several submissions now from individuals stating their strong support for the petition and its aims. Notably, submissions were in favour of authorisation for retention of tissue samples and using scanners for non-invasive post-mortem examinations where possible. It does seem to me that consideration of the petition and the submissions falls into two distinct areas. One is this issue of the authorisation of post-mortems and the extent to which a discretion can be granted to the next of kin in that process. And the second is in relation to the final determination as to where or how the tissue samples that may have been retained, what then befalls them. Monica Lennon has now been able to join us. Welcome, Monica. Delighted to have you with us. And I ask you if there's anything you'd like to say just as we consider these issues afresh this morning.
Thank you, Convener. It's good to be with the committee today and grateful to have the opportunity to speak in support of the petition. I won't repeat some of the points that have been really well made already by the convener, but I'm here today on behalf of my constituent, the petitioner, to hopefully assist and answer any questions that you might have. My constituent and her family really appreciate your consideration so far. It has been really thoughtful and really pleased that your deliberations in December led to more people making submissions. This was not a petition that was put out for public signature, so it has been done in quite a quiet way, but as we can see from the responses, people do have some quite strong views based on their experiences. The issues raised by the petition are very sensitive, and I want to commend the courage of the petitioner. The loss of her son, her adult son Richard, has been devastating and traumatic for the family, but what happened after her son's death was also really traumatic. And in fact, I've just been handed a bundle of papers this morning on my way in, where Anne had been awaiting further information from the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service. I won't go over them here, but it's taken a lot of time for the family to piece together what has happened. And for example, Anne had asked questions about body scanners, which would allow for a less invasive post-mortem, and the Crown Office have come back and identified some training issues there that staff here in Scotland don't have the skill set. So I think looking at all the submissions and the ongoing work that Anne is doing, along with people like Lydia Reid, who I think is known to the committee as well, I think there are just more questions that need to be answered. It would be good to hear, I think, more from the Royal College of Pathology. I note the submission that they've made, and you know they don't give fulsome support for the petitioner, but I think it is concerning that they say this within the context of what they call significant pressures on pathology, post-mortem and forensic services across Scotland. They talk about grossly inadequate facilities and staffing levels being the reality of current provision. And they highlight an issue that I myself was highlighting in the last parliamentary term about the, and I quote, the recent failure of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service procurement exercise to identify compliant bidders for forensic services, further highlighting the challenges already facing the system. So I think we have to question if this system is fit for purpose. You mentioned a couple of the submissions which agree with the petitioner that tissue samples should not be taken and retained without the consent of the next of kin. Their support, including from Dorothy Barr, on the role of body scanners, which are used much more routinely in England, believed to be less invasive, yet 99% accurate. Yvonne Logan in her submission said that it's offensive that people are being told that tissue samples belong to the Procurator Fiscal or Pathologist for research without consent. And I think most people in the public would find this really troubling. Melissa O'Sullivan, a nurse practitioner, supports tissue sample rules aligning with United Kingdom standards and samples being offered back to the next of kin. So I think the petitioner has opened up an important conversation. In the end, I think it comes down to dignity. No one would question the important role and responsibility of the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service when it comes to the investigation of sudden, suspicious, accidental and unexplained deaths in Scotland. But many people feel that the system is not always compassionate, that it's really hard to get information, that communication is not as good as it should be. And we've heard from the Royal College of Pathologists that the system seems unable to cope. So I think there's more questions need to be asked. But I'll end by looking at the submission from Gerard Stark. His question is, where is the dignity for the deceased? We know that this Parliament is about to have a big discussion about dignity in dying. I think we also have to extend that to look at dignity for the deceased and for bereaved families. The petitioner says that her son was butchered. That is her view. She is asking why body scanners are not an option in Scotland. And she doesn't want another mother or family to go through this unbearable heartache and pain. And I did say last word, but I think it's important to also reference the submissions from the Scottish Council of Jewish Communities, who've given a really thoughtful submission. And note their disappointment. I think it's also important that we listen to the views expressed by Skojec. I appreciate these are difficult issues to talk about, and I feel like I've just skimmed over the top of it today because I think a lot of it's upsetting. It's there to be read. The petitioner may feel able to be more public with her story in due course, but I think in terms of the committee, the work you've done so far has helped to show that there are more questions that need to be answered. And you know, if we can improve the law and policy and practice, then we absolutely should. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica. And I think it would be useful if the committee could receive, if we've not already done so, some of the submission that you may be referring to there, because I think you're right. The suggestion that that the procedures and processes being followed might be governed by an under-resourcing of the pathologists' work rather than by any freshly determined view of what best practice and policy might be is concerning. And I think that's one that as a committee we might want to pursue. The fact that body scanners are now being routinely used elsewhere, and if in the submission that we might be yet to see vindicates the view that it may well be that the reason being argued why we can't have this in Scotland is because people aren't adequately trained to use them. That does seem inadequate because obviously the body scanner would be a far less invasive way in which to undertake some of these post-mortems. So I think these might be questions we could come back to if we can consider this, because I think we might want to write to the Crown Office and others just to establish you know, whether or not all of that is correct. In relation to the other evidence and submissions we've received, do colleagues have any suggestions they might like to make? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener, and I thank Monica for her evidence as well this morning. I think it has shone a light on this whole process, and you've identified some of the failings and the lack of support that individuals believe. So I think it would be appropriate for us to write to the Coroner's Society of England and Wales seeking details of its approach to tissue sample retention and how it mitigates the challenges that are set out by the Royal College of Pathologists, because that submission I think will give us an idea of exactly where we are with some of this, because as Monica has identified, a new convener, there seems to be a lack of support here, or there seems to be a lack of training, or there seems to be a lack of identification. And by doing that, at least we would then get an idea of what's happening south of the border that seems to be working in a much better way for individuals with this issue.
Yes, I mean, some of the complexities detailed by the Royal College of Pathologists do seem to be issues that will have to have been faced and addressed elsewhere. Mr. Sweeney, did I see you trying to come in there? Yeah, Paul Sweeney.
I fully agree with the idea. I think the petitioner and several respondents to the petition have been trying to establish parity with other practices in the UK, and I think it's important to thoroughly investigate where those alignments should be. The Royal College's submission, I felt, was a bit excessive in making the point about potential criminal reasons or legal reasons for retaining samples from bodies, because it might, and the implication there I thought was potentially quite offensive, where it was saying that, you know, next of kin might want to defeat the ends of justice by denying a post-mortem. That would be in a very limited and quite significant set of circumstances. I don't think it's relevant to this petition. So I think that we need to sort of understand exactly what they mean by this, and there's probably a thorough investigation needed about what circumstances would samples be retained for a criminal, you know, investigation. And even in due course, once it's established that there's no foul play in relation to the death, those samples can then be released for burial or whatever the family wishes to do with it.
Thank you. I wonder if the committee would be content for me to invite the clerks then to come back to me as well on where we might obtain some further information about body scanners, because I feel that seems quite relevant to our consideration here. And although they've been alluded to, I think we might benefit from some proper briefing on the availability, the costings and the usage. And then that would allow us to pursue with the Crown Office and others why these issues are not being, why we're not deploying them in the way that we might do in Scotland. Are any other suggestions? Well, I think we keep the petition open and pursue all the various matters that we have. Monica Leonard, did you want to add just something?
Yes, Camilla, just to also say that the issue that's been raised by the petitioner and some of the respondents about the death certificate also, the term unascertained is not exactly a popular term, and a lot of families, and I have personal experience of this too, feel that it's quite an empty, meaningless term. And I think some of the respondents have made that point very well. Again, I think Gerard Stark talked about that not being a meaningful term. The uncertain would perhaps be a more appropriate word. And again, I think there's different practice in other parts of the United Kingdom. So if the committee was able to get views on that, perhaps from the Scottish Government and the Crown Office, that also might be useful.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, thank you for drawing that point to our attention. I, as a constituency MSP, have had examples of that too. And it is very, very disturbing. And possibly that word does lead people into a degree of conjecture. In my instance, it was more that they felt something was being covered up as much as anything else in terms of a death in hospital, for example, and not being able to determine what had actually led to that. But yes, I think that would be useful for us to try and pursue as well. Thank you. Are we content? Thank you very much, Monica. Thank you for joining us again. And we'll return to this when we have further information. And that is the end of item one. We now move to item two, which is consideration of new petitions, of which we have two. The first is petition number 1929, to run an advertising campaign to raise public awareness on the forthcoming pavement parking ban, lodged by Bob Downey. And it notes that for drivers to change their behaviour and comply with the forthcoming pavement parking ban, they must buy into, his words, and accept that the needs of pavement users should be given priority over the desire to park as close as possible to their destination or at all. Bob suggests, with the ban not due to come into effect until 2023, the Scottish Government should use the intervening period to ensure that an advertising campaign alerting motorists to the ban and highlighting the negative effects of pavement parking. Scottish Government have restated in their submission their commitment to running such an advertising campaign, highlighting the effects of inconsiderate parking, with a campaign planned for the 6 months preceding the date in which local authorities can begin issuing penalty charge notices for these new offences, excuse me, in 2023. So quite unusually, I think we have a petition where the objectives have actually been realised before we've had a chance to consider it. David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Considering that the Scottish Government are committed to the advertising before the ban comes into place next year, I think we can close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Are we content to do that, colleagues? Paul Sweeney.
I agree, convener, with closing the petition. I would just maybe, in closing the petition, advise the petitioner that the facility of contacting a local member or members of the Scottish Parliament is available to table written questions, for example, closer to the time to get more detail about the nature of the advertising campaign, and if there's further dissatisfaction with how it's running, that could be addressed through their local members of the Scottish Parliament.
That's a very fair point, and I think we can do that as well. Petition number 1931, which is improved the R100 rollout by prioritising properties who currently have speeds of less than 5 Mbps, lodged by Ian Barker, calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to prevent digital exclusion for rural properties and their households by giving priority in the R100 programme to properties with internet speeds of less than 5 Mbps. All legislative and regulatory responsibility for telecommunications rests with UK Government and Ofcom. The Scottish Government has, however, introduced a programme of work to improve digital connectivity in Scotland, which is what the petitioner is seeking to influence. The petitioner is aiming to give priority to properties with slower internet speeds, particularly in rural areas, and he explains that rural households should have fair access to prevent digital exclusion. The Scottish Government's initial response sets out the measures it has taken to date and in relation to rolling out internet connectivity in rural areas. The response also highlights the R100 Scottish Broadband Voucher Scheme, which was created to ensure that everyone can access a superfast broadband service. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think this is a very important petition, especially for those who are in the rurality of... and I think it would be advantageous of us to write to the Scottish Government whether to enact an assessment which has been carried out in advance of the R100 and to the R100 Scottish Broadband Voucher Scheme, which you've identified being introduced to ensure that those most at risk of digital exclusion were protected by that, and in drafting such an impact assessment, how it assessment would rural properties have the slowest internet speeds, and that is the crux of it all, Convener, about the problems that happen in rural areas for individuals who do not have it, and whether it can be taken on other measures to prioritise boosting connectivity of rural households with the lowest internet speeds. These are all vitally important, and I think it's incumbent of us to ask the Scottish Government where we are with all of that, because, as I say, it is an area that is causing huge concern across many rural areas.
Thank you. Fergus Ewing.
Yes, I suppose I should declare a former interest in that I was Minister with responsibility for what has developed in respect of R100, or at least parts of it. I'm just going to suggest, as well as the recommendations which Alexander Stewart suggested, with which I thoroughly concur, it might be helpful, it may be helpful, to also approach the contractors at BT who've been awarded the contracts to seek more practical information from him as to how they go about the quite difficult task of how they sequence and prioritise the rollout of the work, which is very considerable in each of the areas, the three areas of the three separate contracts, and it's not a straightforward matter at all. I think it is also regulated by contract, so I think in writing to the Scottish Government, and if colleagues agree also to the successful contractors, I understand BT, it might also be helpful specifically to ask if the relevant contractual provisions can be shared with us. I don't see any reason why they shouldn't be. Now that the tender process has been completed, they should be in the public domain. So it's really just to flesh out and expand upon Mr. Stewart's suggestions.
Very happy to to add that to our list of considerations. Are colleagues content to proceed on that basis? We are. Thank you very much. And that concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. We will be meeting unusually and by exception next Thursday, the 12th of May, when we'll be meeting virtually, colleagues, to take evidence from Shoulders Hospital in Canada. Delighted that we've managed to make contact with them and establish this meeting ahead of our subsequent meeting with the Minister. And we'll be taking evidence from them on the topic of mesh and natural tissue repairs, in which they have developed a particular expertise. And on that note, but just before we do move into private session, colleagues may have noticed that we've been joined by a new clerk this morning. So can I welcome Miriam Dornan, who is with us at the first... she's hidden, but who is with us for the first time this morning. And on that note, we move into private session. Thank you.